Hi, I'm Hugh Jackman.
And I'm Patrick Stewart.
Welcome to the Graham Norton Show.
Yes, Hugh Jackman and Patrick Stewart are here. Yeah. How exciting is that? They're the stars of Logan, the new X-Men movie. In this film, an elderly, ailing Professor X has been cared for by Wolverine. Aww. Remind you of anyone? Yeah. you know what? I'm not sure Wolverine caring for Professor X is a great idea. I mean, you wouldn't want those hands wiping your bum, you just have to... Could you? No, don't worry. Hey, did everyone watch non-league Sutton play Arsenal in the FA Cup? Yeah! Really? I didn't. Hey, much controversy though. Basically, The Sun published official odds on Sutton United reserve goalie Wayne Shaw eating a pie on camera before the end of the game. And you do wonder, why is he the reserve goalie? Ah, yes, I see. suspiciously, once the bet was official, Wayne was clearly seen eating a pie, and it raises a lot of questions. Mainly, who let him be in a football team? I mean... In the end, poor Wayne was forced to resign from the team. Aww. He said he's left the club with a heavy heart. Imagine it's all the cholesterol. So we've got a great show for you with some surprises along the way. Later, we'll have the new single from the marvellous James Blunt. Yes! Let's meet the stars of Logan! He's been captain of the Enterprise, the world's most powerful professor, and is a real-life knight of the realm. Please welcome the great Sir Patrick Stewart is here! Yes! Yes! Hello, sir.
So nice to see you.
Lovely to see you.
Look at you.
Sports. He sings, he dances, he kicks ass. Please welcome Wolverine himself. It's the fabulous Hugh Jackman! Hello! Hello! Very nice to see you. Come in, sit down. They're happy now. They're very happy now. Very happy. Welcome to you both.
Where's me mum? My mum's out there tonight. Where's mum?
Oh.
There's mum.
This is it.
Hey! Hey, mum!
Wow!
You're a lucky man.
I'm lucky.
Oh, and a lucky mother. It's all good. Welcome to our shores.
What do you mean, welcome to your shores?
Ooh, careful.
Trouble! Uh-oh. Well, that was literally like a second into the show.
Right. Yes.
I didn't know how we got. Welcome to the show, I said.
Get into it, it's too complicated.
All right. I trust you, you're a mother. anyway, lovely to have you here, thank you. And thank you for your son.
Thanks, Mum.
Welcome to you both. And now, you've been on the show a few times. I didn't know you had a nickname.
Which one do you know? Which one do you have?
One beginning with G.
Oh.
rhymes with puppy?
A guppy.
Yes.
Yeah. Because when I sleep, I move around. And someone saw me on a plane, who I know well, and I was sleeping on the plane. I said, I had a great sleep. They went, really? You are like a guppy out of water, like a fish out of water, just flip-flopping around. So guppy.
What? Have you seen him be a guppy?
Sleeping?
Yes.
I've right, never seen
right,
him sleeping.
All right.
I'm not hiding anything.
My mum's here. Hey, Mum. Restless sleeper. It's quite adorable, really.
It's adorable. It's a little guppy. Because you had nicknames growing up, didn't you?
Yeah, I did. Stewpot was one of my nicknames. Stewie was another one.
Of course.
It's different now. I'm now, social media, Sir Pat Stew, and at Sir Pat Stew.
Nice plug.
Nice.
Oh, seamless.
Followers. Up.
Seamless.
And there's another one too, Beef Stew, which I rather like.
That's very appropriate. Very appropriate.
Thank you.
We'll call you Beef Stew for the rest of the show. That's it.
Yeah. Would you?
Yeah, big beefer.
And afterwards.
And afterwards. Yes.
Absolutely.
Now, big movie tonight is Logan. Logan. It's out Wednesday, the 1st of March.
I like the way you say that. Like, no. You should be doing the voiceover.
Voice, he should. Yeah. I'd love to. That's great. But I say it again.
I don't think I can keep it up for a whole trailer, though.
Really?
I'd be Logan. 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 Wednesday, the 1st of March. And it's one of those films, because whenever one of these X-Men films comes out, there's huge excitement. But this one, it's exciting for an audience, but it must be kind of tinged with sadness for both of you.
Well, it is my last outing. I'm not saying it's not your last outing. This is only here. I'll tell you
about it in a moment, should the opportunity arise.
I think it's arisen. This is the
Well, Chacho, chatting. Go.
Hugh has been on record for some time that this is his last appearance as Logan, as Wolverine. I never thought about that, whether it was mine. It was another great opportunity to be in this franchise. But on Friday night, we were in Berlin at the film festival, and it screened there. Hugh and I were sitting side by side, although the other way around. And when it got into the...
Facing the screen, right?
No, it wasn't like that at all.
At all.
But we got into the last 5 or 6 minutes of the movie, and it's a very emotional ending. And I saw Hugh just do this a little bit, and I suddenly realized, oh, Lord, I need to do the same thing. And then this is what I felt.
Oh, yeah.
I swear, that was what happened. Hugh held my hand, and of course, I was done. I was finished there, just weeping and sobbing. But then we had to wait for the credits to roll before we could go up on stage and be introduced. And while the credits were rolling, because they are long in these movies, I realized if this is the end, there is no more perfect and beautiful way to say au revoir, goodbye, adios, than what has just happened. So I think it's the end for me, too.
Whoa! Wow. Yeah. Really?
Yeah, really? Sure. Why would I want to do another go at this after what we've done in this movie? Because this movie is really, really good. And it is
terrific.
He's in it.
Oh,
are you going to show something?
Don't worry, we'll get to that bit.
You're not putting it off.
Oh, no, we've got clips and all sorts. Yeah, yeah. Okay. We prepared.
Of course.
I've got some questions. No, but it is a very emotional film. It is.
Yeah, yeah, and I think as we made it, as we prepared it, James Mangold, the filmmaker who wrote it as well, for 2.5 years, and Patrick was there. There was a small band of real believers. I thought the studio would say no, not to be honest, but they didn't. Emma and Steve said yes, and we made this film that was deeply personal and a very different kind of X-Men film. I kind of want people to go and see it who have never seen an X-Men film, never seen a comic book movie. We wanted to make a movie that was true to that character. As I sat there in Berlin, I did. I reached and I grabbed Patrick's hand, A, because it was 17 years since we first started playing it. I mean, you go to school for 12 years. That's a long time at school, right? This is 17 years, and I couldn't quite believe that there I was sitting next to one of my heroes. And I'm not just saying that to be nice. I was at drama school watching the John Barton How to Play Shakespeare tapes with Patrick playing Shylock, and I thought, one day I want to work with him. And there I was. It was a dream come true, and it was I realized how lucky I am and will forever be grateful to be in this movie, and it was very emotional.
And why now, though? Because you could have... Because Wolverine's such a popular character.
Yeah.
Won't you feel just gutted if they recast and bring... Someone else is playing Wolverine?
I think I'll be fine. I mean, look, if I wake up one day and I find out Daniel Day-Lewis is playing the part and he wins the Oscar, I'm getting me a little... And everyone says, wow, now that is Wolverine.
It won't happen.
I'll tell you what, let's have a taste of what to expect.
At last.
You're in it. You'll love it. You'll love it. You're excellent in this. I would keep myself.
I would find a way. Logan. Still have time.
Even that is amazing. It's so good.
Why are we talking about violence?
No, see, even that isn't like isn't like a normal kind of, you know, Marvel trailer. It's fantastic. It's beautiful.
It's not. It's very different. And I remember being there when they first played us that trailer, you remember? And with Johnny Cash song, which just seemed so perfect. Yeah. And, of course, our director did walk the line, so he didn't know they were going to use that Johnny Cash song. But it is perfect. I'm very proud of it and...
So tell us about what the last film is, a taste of what happened.
Well, they've even given a date for this one. It's 2029, so it's 12 years ahead of now. We are a little older, in my case, only a little older. Charles is 90-ish, thereabouts. He's frail, weak, defenseless, troubled, aggressive, hostile, confused, and most importantly, funny occasionally.
Funny.
Yeah. Funny. Thank you for that. And
might I add, sexy. Ooh. I'm throwing him out there. Beef Stew, don't look at me that way.
Now, the last adjective I was going to add was
juicy.
Okay, juicy. And very, very dangerous. He has lost control of this power that he has in his brain. And so this guy has got a daytime and nighttime job trying to make a little bit of money living in this little part of desert northern Mexico in order to pay for my medications. Is that familiar to anybody at all? That's the kind of movie this is, with storylines like that.
Yeah. And now, normally when you see a film, the film starts in the film, look even better than they do in real life. Not being rude. You look a bit rough around the edges in this film.
Yeah. I mean, Patrick came to set, it was quite shocking because you'd lost 21 pounds. Uh-huh. And I remember you telling me you were this, like you were at 14, the same weight you've been your entire life. Uh-huh. And I spent about 6 hours every morning in makeup, to get... No, it was literally like 6 seconds. Get out of the car. I said, I'll go to makeup. They're like, you're good.
Well, we've got to say, though, in just in case people are worried...
Right.
When Wolverine takes his shirt off, you're still in quite the condition. But for people who are kind of going, oh, yeah, I'll go to the gym, I'll look like that, describe... Like the lead up to a day when you know you're filming a shirt off scene.
Well, yeah, there's a thing called dehydration. So do not try this at home, but you can lose up to 10 pounds of, which is 4 kilos of weight on your surface. Like, so all of this under here is water. So you drink a lot of water for a week, getting up to maybe 10 liters a day. And then you stop about 30 hours before you film. And so for the next 10 hours, you're just peeing constantly because you've been drinking, so your body's used to it. And then all this water is going in. You have like a half a baked potato and a few other things that suck water from the inside, and then it's kind of not fun, but the results end up being pretty good. Again, do not try this.
Unless you're getting married next weekend. Just for the final push for the dress.
But you will have a massive headache for the entire wedding.
No, do you just feel awful? You must feel
bad.
Terrible.
You feel bad and you have a headache.
Tell them about the meals. You standing on the set eating. Like
you eat every 2 hours and it's like 6,500 calories a day. So for me, it was a lot. And Mum, not your cooking either, like steamed chicken and steamed broccoli.
That
not
was
like
it.
Your beautiful stuff. Yeah.
But then, so that's how you did it.
Yes.
But in a film. Patrick, how did you do? You're not even in a film in this picture. This is just you hanging out.
What? Come on.
That's last year, right? Yeah. Last year. Do you gym all the time?
No, sir, I do not. I just think clean thoughts. I'm embarrassed about that photograph. The whole purpose of the photograph was the pink motif. The shoes, the shorts, the cocktail.
Doesn't go with beef stew. It doesn't go with beef stew. It's sorry.
But no, you're in fantastic condition.
Thank you.
Is
thank
it
you.
Yoga? Right.
No, I was, you know, it, I was born
you do
with
do
it. Thank you, my mother and father. They gave me great skin and they gave me this
physique. You do yoga? Maybe over the years you
No. I tried it. It was not for me.
Right.
It hurt.
Right. Tell us about it.
And this is weird, and don't answer this question if you don't want to, Patrick. Okay. But I have... I don't know why you brought this up, but I did hear you discuss that you had an extraordinary disagreement with your wife about yourself. Do you know what I'm talking about?
By myself, you mean...
Yes.
Yeah.
Ooh.
Listen, do you know this story?
I do not know
Listen
this
with story. Interest.
One night, as you do, we were talking about stuff, and... I just had no interest in, and of course, being circumcised, I said.
They were chatting, they're married. They're married, they're allowed.
And she said, you're not circumcised. I said, what do you mean? You've only known me a few, all my life. I remember my mother telling me why, because it was fashionable at the time. She said, you're not circumcised. I said, that's ridiculous. I should know if I'm circumcised. Conversation. But the next day, I happened to be seeing my doctor. Are you okay? I was seeing my doctor for my annual physical.
Of course.
So, while he was down there, I said,
excuse me, doctor.
Oh, by the way, Irv, my wife and I had a little disagreement. I am circumcised, aren't I? Because she says I'm not. And he goes... not. I said, no, it's not possible. So he looked down again and he said, hey, I'm Jewish, I know the difference.
That is a bizarre story.
Too much of it. I have grandchildren.
You're going to have to change your Facebook status now.
Yes. No more beef stew.
Well, there's more beef stew. Dear. Oh. But now, what is lovely, because acting is a kind of transient thing, you meet people and then you don't, but one of the lovely things that came out of these films is your friendship with Ian McKellen. Now, do you know, had you, but you must have known Ian McKellen before the films.
Oh, yes, since I was a teenager. He's 2 years older than me. he said something the other day, really, along with what he was just said, one of the nicest things ever. He said, yeah, Patrick Stewart and I really feel that at last I have a brother.
Oh, that's adorable.
He might have said father, of course.
You have a kind of a theory about the way he speaks, the way Ian McKellen speaks.
Well, we did an animated movie together, as well as these.
You did?
Yeah, it was called Flushed Away. I really love... My son often says, why was there no sequel to that? And I said, because I lost a lot of money. But... I always remember he played the toad, Rita. Hello, Rita. And I was always like, he can get, like, consonants where there's nothing... Like, he can make a one-syllable word into 20.
OK, here's a test for you. A test for you. If you shut your eyes...
Yes.
Shut your eyes. Okay. Is this the real voice of Ian McKellen, or is it somebody doing Ian McKellen?
Okay.
Graham, is there room for another mutant on that sofa of yours?
That's the real...
That's him.
That's the real... It is him. Yeah, yes, it is. Come out, Ian McKellen!
Hello, darling.
Hi, lovely to see you.
Thank you so much for coming.
Have a seat, too. Have a seat.
I see you, brothers. I should just explain why I'm dressed as I am. I've just come down from Scotland, and it took longer to get from City Airport to us than it took to get from Edinburgh to City Airport. So I'm still in the clothes I was wearing up there.
Well, you're very welcome.
I am wearing it. You look lovely. Do you recognise this? Yes, this is Magneto's coat.
Is it really?
Yeah, they gave it to me. It's in red. Do you remember the red? Yeah. Look at it now.
Yes.
Oh, that is so great.
So I'm just hoping someone's watching. And Neil and Fred can help me.
Well, there you go.
My mum can do this. She's very good with that stuff.
Yeah. Not working. No, you're not working tonight. I refuse. I'll drape it there.
Yeah.
Sit down. You're very welcome.
I've got more to tell you about my clothes.
Please do.
I was at Kirkcaldy High School, telling them to be nice to each other. I go around schools doing that. Gordon...
Ramsay?
No.
Brown?
Right.
Prime Minister, yes. He'd been at that school. And they gave me their school tie, and I said, well, I'm going on the Graham Norton show, and I'll wear the tie. So I had to wear it. So there, that's for Cookeddy.
Nice.
They also gave me these...
Shoeless.
But they're rainbow. They're rainbow.
Are they footballer anti bullying on football?
And footballers who approve of gay people coming out and being honest about themselves wear these to show their support. So here we are. I'm wearing.
There you go. Well, it's lovely to have you here. It's a lovely surprise. Now, here's the thing though, because the guys are talking about this movie Logan, which is part of the X-Men
franchise.
I've
never heard of it, to tell you.
How come you're not in it?
Do you know, I think when you get to my age, you want to leave aside those tired old franchises. You know, move on to something fresh.
I sometimes
cry myself to sleep. I simply don't know how I don't... I don't know why I'm not in it, darling. Could you not do another one? leave this one out. It's time you died. And as I remember, Professor X, you did die in one of the movies.
Oh, yeah. I was vaporized
by... But he's resurrected.
Yeah, but that's nothing. It was only at the level of DNA that he was vaporized. I mean, of course they can come back together.
Oh, I see. Good.
Come on.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
I remember, can I just say, because... I wanted to say thank you to you all these years. I'm sure I have. I hope I have. I was very nervous on that first film. I started 3 weeks in. It was my first movie, and there was a lot going on, and there was a lot of people. And I remember you pulling me aside and saying, this at times is going to feel uncomfortable, it's going to feel overwhelming, but you're in good hands and everything's going to be okay. And you, both of you, were such heroes of mine. I was a little starstruck, but you, it was the first day I met you. And you saying that to me, I never, ever forgot it.
I was in love with you.
And then we kissed.
But I'd seen you at the National Theatre in a musical. What was it?
It was Oklahoma.
Oh, what a beautiful moment, you know.
I took your dressing room straight after you.
Did you?
I took a photo, yeah.
Did I leave anything behind?
That's a nice surprise.
Had I known it was you, I would have done. This is a very saucy show.
It certainly is. But Patrick was talking before you came out about that you'd sort of known each other over the years. But were you kind of rivals in your careers or not?
No, only recently. I've never thought of having rivals. Everyone gets on with what they can do, and there's plenty of room for everybody. But sometimes I think I am Patrick Stewart, except that he's Yorkshire. I'm sorry about that, but you are.
Lancastrian.
Yes, I'm from Lancashire. But our interests are the same as far as a career is concerned. We started with the RSC. We wanted to do Royal Shakespeare Company. We wanted to do Shakespeare. We wanted to be taken seriously as actors. But given the chance... Of another sort of work, a very popular sort of work. Of course, we leapt at it. Couldn't quite believe our luck that we'd been asked.
Absolutely.
Or in your case, asked back again and again.
So young and so bitter.
But I heard you talking about Ian and talking about how you were intimidated by his beauty.
Yes. Well,
Yes, I
know. Please tell me you have a photograph.
This was a long time ago.
Gorgeous.
I think we do have a photograph. We've got a photograph of Ian as Coriolanus. Here we are.
Look at that.
Come on.
Oh, my Lord.
Wolverine, eat your heart.
Having said that, you do look great there, Ian, but check out Patrick Stewart. There you go. Yeah.
Well, you know. You know?
I have an answer what you've got to look forward to.
But I'll tell you something you've been hearing about this amazing body. It is absolutely amazing. And a privilege to be so close. But, you know, Magneto, the character I used to play in this tired old franchise... Well, was also pretty muscular, wasn't he?
Yeah.
And
he was.
There you can see. Yeah. But the trick is that I am wearing underneath my costume a suit, which is sculpted to look as if I've put all the effort as he has into it.
Yeah. You knew that?
Huh?
Did you know that?
They said you've got to work out. McKellen's working out, you've got to work out.
I just put on the suit. And I'll tell you what, I've still got it at home. I do wear it on occasion. Why have you two got drinks and I don't?
Yeah, that's a good point.
Would you like a drink? We've got red wine if you
red
want.
Red wine.
Red wine. Red wine. Oh, look at that. Psychic.
What?
Oh, Lord. Water and red wine.
Thank you. Wow.
Let's just shout out drinks and see if they show up.
Any nibbles?
Oh, are we doing that? We're doing all that.
Cheers, Don.
Cheers, cheers, cheers. Lovely to see you. Oh, look, people.
Well, and what's all this about you being circumcised?
Come on, you shared a dressing room.
I know, I know.
You know.
So, you worked together. You worked together on Broadway. You did two plays together on Broadway.
The same, so brilliant.
Yeah.
Oh, yes.
Yes.
You know, there are not many plays where there are two wonderful parts for actors of the same age. So you can go through your life never working with the people you admire and the people who you have an awful lot in common with. Shakespeare's not bad to that extent. Mm-hmm. But there are a few plays, and one of them is Waiting for Godot, and there are two wonderful parts for people of the same age. And another one is No Man's Land by Harold Pinter, and we've done them both. And we've just finished doing No Man's Land in London. Though, don't despair. If you missed it, you can catch it on NT Live. They record a performance.
Oh, the cinema, the BBC cinemas.
Show it in cinemas. And
I have just had an idea.
What?
This is awesome. For some time now, I have been teasing Hugh, but getting more and more serious about a theatre job we might do together. Oh. I have been saying to this man for a long time, he should play Stephen Sondheim's Sweeney Todd. It is as if the role might have been written for him. Oh. And I add a rider that if he plays Sweeney Todd, I will, for a limited run, play the judge, which is a two-scene role, but with two numbers, including a duet between the two of them. Mm. Who should play Mrs. Lovett?
That is a good idea.
Have a little priest.
That's a good idea.
That's a really good idea.
There's a nice juvenile part that Eddie Redmayne played in the movie. Oh.
Yeah.
I could play a pie.
Can you
As we very briefly must mention, Beauty and the Beast, Ian's new film. It's in cinemas from the 17th of March. And it's not just you, it's fabulous people. Emma Watson, Dan Stevens, Emma Thompson, Ewan McGregor. And who are you in the world of Beauty and the Beast?
Well, in my view, the film should be called Beauty and the Clock. Does that give you a
I can't wait.
I play Cogsworth the Clock.
If it ain't Baroque, don't fix it.
There we go. But, you know, he is a great song and dance man. I mean, that's how I first saw Hugh on stage at the National Theatre, singing his heart out. And then he did a show on Broadway, which hasn't yet come to England, Boy from Oz.
Yeah.
And you've got a one-man show when you sing and dance.
Mm.
Now, Patrick does a bit of singing. You've made a lovely record of your version of some standards, haven't you, with Sonny? Mm. And I thought it was time that I got into the musical side of the business.
You're singing. Well, yes.
Now, I think we've got to pick. This is you.
Yes, that's me. Yes.
I voiced that clock.
Yes.
And at the end, I'm not giving away any secrets, I think, when the prince stops being a beast...
the spell thing.
I come back as myself, and that's when you see me...
Got it.
But very brief.
Oh, OK, OK. We do have a little taster. This features your clock in action.
Oh.
Look out for it, there's two hands on it. The jokes write themselves. Here's today's Beauty and the Beast.
How lovely to make your acquaintance.
Want to see me do a trick?
What happens when the last petal falls?
The Mastel remains a beast forever.
And we become antiques.
You've been in it.
That was one of my first shows. My first theatre show was Beauty
Stage
and the Beast.
Show.
Gaston.
There he is, it's Gaston.
You've been dreaming just one dream. Yes, nearly all your life. Hoping, scheming, just one theme. Will you be my wife?
Now, yes. Patrick, you are getting into the animation world as well. It's just been announced your exciting new casting.
Yes.
Tell us who you're playing.
Why are you laughing?
Because I know what the answer is.
Well, there is to be an emoji movie.
Yes, Patrick.
And among the top three most popular emojis of all time is one that I will play, and his name is... Poop!
It's... Look at this. It's Professor Excrement. Not my own. Have you got the voice for Poop yet?
Yes, he sounds rather like this. He's quite grand and very well spoken. Very, very, very English, which I think is a clever idea. Not mine, but the producers, that he should be very English.
Hey, listen, we're about to have music, but very quickly, it is Oscars weekend, this weekend, and Ian, would you mind telling us the story about when you were nominated for Gandalf?
Oh, yeah.
And you had the beads.
Yes.
Yeah.
Well, they weren't beads. In New Zealand, where we filmed Lord of the Rings, if you're lucky, when you leave, you're given a piece of green stone carved, and you wear it often enough, and your chances are that you'll get back to New Zealand. That's the idea. And it'll bring you a bit of luck. So, when those films were nominated for something like 20 Oscars on that night, everybody from New Zealand was wearing their greenstone, their punami, they're called. And when we were on the red carpet going into the ceremony, I met Maggie Smith. Hello, what are you here for? I said, well... I said, well, Lord of the Rings. Oh, yeah. She said, what's that round your neck? Oh, I said, it's my punami, Maggie. Oh, your punami, what's that for? I said, well, if I wear it, it'll bring me luck, and... oh, very nice. And we went our separate ways, and, you know, it lasts for 3.5 or 4 hours, you know, don't you?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Oh, God, you sit there and sit there. And at the end, of course, everyone else wins the Oscar apart from you. And a bit dejected, you're coming out looking forward to a drink, and you bump into Maggie Smith, and she points out at you, and she says, it didn't work, didn't it?
Have a seat, too.
Thank you so much.
Yeah, well done, you. And that's off your new album, The Afterlove, which is released on the 24th of March.
Yes, thank you for the plug.
Well, you know, that's why you're here. So that song is about kind of some of the hate you've received over the years.
Yeah, it's a little bit about, yeah, how deeply unpopular I am, but it doesn't matter because my wife loves me.
Aww. But also...
Don't say after me, say after her. Poor, poor girl.
No, but you have turned it to a strength, the way that people are kind of rude about you.
Yeah, I mess around, don't I? I mess around online, on Twitter, abusing myself before people...
Yes. Have you guys... Do you follow him on Twitter?
No.
You should. He's very good. Sorry, we've got some examples of James's tweets. Can we all take a moment to remember just how terrible James Blunt was? No need. I have a new album coming soon. James Blunt is a Twitter. What would he even tweet about? Boning your mom. This one. James Blunt es solo peor que le said Hitler. I'm guessing this is not good. Do you know what that means?
No, I have no idea.
Little bit of James Blunt never hurt anybody. Depends where I put it. This is so weird. I have this dire need to listen to James Blunt when I'm menstruating. Useful feedback. I'll pass this on to my marketing team. And, James Blunt's face fully aggravates me, then sit on something else. Now, Hugh Jackman,
yes.
You share something with James Blunt in that you have both done one of the most difficult jobs in show business. You have both performed at an Australian sporting event.
Oh, wow. Oh, yes, you did. What did, was it the AFL Grand Final?
I did the State of Origin.
State of Origin?
That's yeah.
What's that?
Which is 40,000 Aussie, drunk Aussie yeah. men. Very, very aggressive, macho men. And for the mid-game entertainment, some guy, some comedian booked James Blunt. To sing 40,000 people, you're beautiful.
You're beautiful.
I'm still alive, but only
No, did it turn ugly?
I wore the kind of home team's top just to, well to, least to try and, yeah, smart. Which I think was like a shield.
Which one did you do, you?
I did the Bledisloe Cup, so Australia, New Zealand, rugby. That was the first thing I did, singing the national anthem, and I did the rugby league grand final, but both terrifying, absolutely terrifying. I remember the... I remember being introduced at the Bledisloe Cup as a star of stage and screen. I'd done one stage show on one TV show at the time. Ladies and gentlemen, star of stage, Mr. Hugh Jackman. I realised I was standing in front of the Great Southern Stand with 30,000 New Zealanders booing me. And the Australian captain standing next to me goes, you better bloody show him, mate. No pressure, anyway. Yeah,
that but was... you went for it.
I so went for it. It's embarrassing. If you ever see the tape of it, I finish singing. They actually, I'm still singing, they cut off, the tape finishes, they cut off the microphone. And I'm still singing, like, I've never been more nervous in my life. I mean, you're right, an Australian crowd, if you
They take
do...
it very seriously. I mean, Meatloaf isn't allowed back in the country after his performance.
I have to ask, Ian, have you ever sung before a national sporting event?
Not yet, no, I haven't.
Sign him up.
I did perform at in front of 50,000 people at the Gay Games in New York.
Did you sing?
But I didn't sing, no. I had a very good line. I said, my name's Sir Ian McKellen, but you can call me Serena. That went down very well. Do you think that would go down in Australia?
Yes.
Sure would.
Absolutely.
Oh, yes.
Absolutely. Right. Give it a whirl.
I mean, all Australian men are gay, aren't they? There's just always a little bit of ting of gay about
it. This is a minefield, right?
James Blunt. James Blunt, are you going on tour?
Oh, yes.
You can all thank me later. Where are you going? Tell us, we're interested.
I'm going on tour around the UK in November. Tickets are on sale now, Graham, but I'll get you a freebie.
Oh, you're so... That's very good. And can we just say, James Blunt working on his birthday. Happy birthday, James
Thank
Blunt.
You.
Yeah.
Thank you. All of you.
Nearly it for tonight. Before we go, just time for a visit to the big red chair. Who's there?
Hello.
Hi, what's your name?
Jenny.
Jenny, lovely. And what do you do, Jenny?
I'm a wildlife veterinarian.
Well, now, we've never had one of those on the show before. So do you just go and look for sick animals? Yes, okay. That's what Jenny, she's great with animals. She's very good with animals, they love her. Where are you based?
At the moment, at London Zoo.
All right, so they're quite easy to catch there. Not so hard. I wonder if I'll see any animals today. All right, Jenny, off you over the story.
I had just started working at a chimpanzee sanctuary in Sierra Leone, and an old hand was showing me around and introduced me to Chippy, a young male chimp, and she said, Chippy loves rubber boots, wellies. And I was wearing some beautiful flowered wellies that very day, so I kind of put them towards the cage, and an expression of delight came on Chippy's face, and he rushed over. And I was like, he really does like wellies. And he crouched down and immediately started masturbating himself on the sole of my wellies.
I'm going to say, everything about that story was hilarious. Chippy the chimp. Like, really, you're running a sanctuary, that's all you can come up with? Chippy? Okay. Is it the only one you've got? Okay, we have one more, here we go. Hello.
Hi.
Hi, what's your name?
Fliss.
Fliss?
Yeah, terrible name with a lisp.
What? No.
Right,
aren't we? Fliss is your actual name?
Well, Felicity.
Oh, OK, but you went with Fliss. OK. All right, Fliss, off you go with your story.
So, me and my sister were driving to Scotland, and I needed the toilet, so we stopped at service stations. I ran in, I went into the first cubicle, and there was a massive, big, floating shit in the toilet.
Patrick's right here!
I know, I'm so sorry. Anyway, I left.
That angle.
But yes, I walked straight out, went into the next cubicle, I went for a wee, and then I stood washing my hands. And a lady walked in while I was washing my hands. I kind of caught her eye in the reflection, and she walked into the first cubicle, obviously saw the big shit, Patrick, in the toilet.
Dear.
And then walked out. So I just kind of casually went to her, like, oh, I did that. Meaning I had walked in and walked out.
Well done, everyone. If you'd like to join us on the show and have a go on that red chair, you can. Just contact us via our website at this very address. And that is it for tonight. Please say you. Thank you to my guest, Mr. James Blunt. Thank you, Stewart. In April. Do join me next week, though, for a look back at some of the highlights from this series. I'll see you then. Good night, everybody. Bye-bye.